Buenas tardes, les habla Víctor López Ramírez, presidente de Educando con Cultura y su proyecto bandera Tacuafán, Taller Cultural Afroantillano. Tacuafán es una entidad sin fines de lucro dedicada a promover el acervo musicocultural de Puerto Rico y el Caribe. Tacuafán nace en la comunidad del Barrio Obrero en 1983 y dedica un programa multicultural a la figura de Arturo Alfonso Schomburg, los tradicionales cánticos del Rosario de la Santa Cruz de Mayo, los 100 años de la fundación de los Barrios Obreros y la vida y la obra de Antonia Pantoja Acosta, de Barrio Obrero Santurce. Para los que éramos residentes de Barrio Obrero, todo comenzó cuando la doctora Pantoja fundó en el 1970 el primer Aspira de Puerto Rico, al cual tuve la oportunidad de pertenecer. Para esa época, éramos jóvenes en busca de progreso educativo y Aspira de Barrio Obrero nos brindó esa oportunidad. Para ese momento conformamos la primera clase graduanda de escuela superior que luchó y exigió entrada a la Universidad del Estado, la Universidad de Puerto Rico, gracias a los esfuerzos del programa Aspira de Puerto Rico. Hoy puedo decir con gran orgullo de haber sido parte de ese gran primer grupo de Aspira y en este momento poder hacer una contribución dedicándole este humilde reconocimiento a la doctora Antonia Pantojas. También hacemos una invitación a los que no la conocieron a que la conozcan a través de este gran documental realizado por la cineasta Lilian Jiménez, el cual tituló Presente. Que lo disfruten.
I'm Edward James Olmos. Welcome to Voices, a journey into the heart and soul of Latino culture. With every edition of Voices, we offer a look into the lives of extraordinary people who have made enormous contributions to our country. This presentation highlights the life of an educator whose commitment to her community changed the lives of thousands. Every now and then, one person will stand up and become the voice of a generation. One person will raise their hand to demand more for the community. And one person will be remembered as a catalyst for change, a true leader. For a generation of young people who knew her, that person is Dr. Antonia Pantoja. Dr. Pantoja was a visionary, and in the world of education, she is legendary. She founded Aspira, a grassroots educational organization that empowered Puerto Rican youth to take control of their future and encouraged generations of Latinos to dare to dream. Latino Public Broadcasting and Voices are proud to bring you Antonia Pantoja, Presente.
Major funding for Voces was provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. Additional funding was provided by the Ford Foundation. Additional funding was provided by the MacArthur Foundation. Promotional support for Voces is provided by Hispanic Communications Network, a leading educational media company for U.S. Hispanics.
She was a Puerto Rican first, last, and always, and that's what she believed in.
She was like this very tiny person that was like a lion.
I think that Tony's vision was to create organizations that would have an impact on Puerto Rican communities.
So she had a far reach, and not everybody welcomed that reach.
Dr. Pantoja is an example of someone who had a vision, who believed in themselves, and who created what they talked about. Rather than sit back and say, we need this and I wish we had it, she said, we need this and this is how we can get it.
I really see her as the servant leader. She devoted her whole life to really doing things for others. Not many people like Toni Pantoja in this world.
You cannot live a life that is lukewarm. You gotta live a life of commitment and passion, a passionate life. And by passion, I mean passion in that sense. The passion of doing, of producing, of thinking, of dealing with making the world a better place. I like the water. And it has a special meaning to me, the sound, the, you know, la espuma, the waves in and out, the constant movement in and out. And you suspect, I mean, what is all that strength that rushes in and out? Why does it rush in and out?
I remember going to Puerto Rico, I remember sitting, going to her apartment in Isla Verde, a beautiful apartment right on the beach. Began to talk about her experience, her full life, her musings. And it was at that point when I said to her, I said, you have to write the book.
I never thought about writing a book about me. In fact, when I started to sit down to write, I said, how does one write a book about oneself? How do you start? I was born in Puerta de Tierra, the outskirts of the old city, San Juan. When one is born, one comes out of a sack. And my comadrona broke the sack in time, and so I was saved. So that means that you're special. So my grandmother used to tell people when they come to the house, Toñita, come here. Show them your hands. So I would go and show my hands. And she said, she has a special destiny. So, you know, when you hear that more than once, as a child, you believe it. Puerto Rico was the poorhouse of the Caribbean. We were a very poor place where people didn't eat. In my house, there were times when my mother or my grandmother would give us a piece of old bread and some water with sugar and say, everybody to sleep early before the stomach wakes up. And we didn't have anything to eat in the day. This is why I got tuberculosis. My grandfather is really very handsome. He was a cigar maker. Many of the cigar makers that were independent workers in small shops went into this big, enormous factory, American Tobacco Company. And my whole family worked there. They organized a strike because they wanted about 5 cents increase. And they were meeting, and some of the men that were being hired to be the strike breakers came in, and they pushed the hot oil to the men, and my grandfather got a lot of it on him. And they brought him up in arms into the house. And everybody was very upset, and I was very upset. I remember that very vividly. I guess that I learned about my organizing from those days. I had gone to the university for 2 years and gotten what they call a normal school diploma that prepare you to teach in the lower grades. So I was teaching in the hills, in the country. Here you are teaching, and they owe me 4 months of salary. The municipality wouldn't pay you. And one day, I resigned the school. That was a terrible thing to do because I was the breadwinner. The place was oppressive to me. It was too small. The family was with their demands, the traditional things that a woman is supposed to do in that culture. And I was loaded with responsibilities that I felt are too heavy on me. I must have been about 19.
She had this constant conflict with Puerto Rico. It was her country, she loved it, she was born there. But she could see all the contradictions. She could see all the limitations in the role for her as a poor person, as a black person. She didn't feel she fit.
I was sort of bursting, you know. I wanted something else. I was in search of something. I didn't know exactly what. The United States for a Puerto Rican was depicted in the movies. And as a child, I used to go to the movies and see Mickey Rooney and Judy Garland, and I loved Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers. And I thought, oh my God, I would like to live in a place like that. I'm deciding to leave the island when there's a war. The only way to get out, there were no airplanes. You got out in a ship. The Atlantic Ocean was mine with German submarines. So I left Puerto Rico with this suitcase made of cardboard from the 5 and 10 tied up with a rope. I started to see a world opening that I had never known of. I was having the time of my life.
I've heard the stories of her coming to New York, and she told me of the parties where she lived, really in a commune, in an old church that they had rented. She was wild. She was wild.
Talking about all kinds of things of art, and sometimes there'll be a presentation in one room. Somebody will read Nietzsche or Kierkegaard, read in Russian, a piece of Dostoevsky, and I will read in Spanish.
Conmigo cabalgando, seguí por la sombra del tiempo y me hice paisaje lejos de mi visión.
I became a New Yorker the right way, through art and the artist. The migration from Puerto Rico was getting to be very large. Why did we migrate? Because things in Puerto Rico are not good, there's not enough employment, and you are going out looking for a better way of life. People were coming to work in the factories. But, you know, the factories were really terrible places, you know. The children in the school were also in a horrible situation. They did not understand what was being said by the teacher. And nobody bothered about that. And the dropout rate was tremendous. And I started then to say, oh, God, you know, we really live in a terrible situation in this city.
I remember having dinners that were just basically rice and beans and a fried egg. There was no meat to be had. Rice and beans, we always had rice and beans.
My mother was looking for an apartment on Dawson Street in the Bronx. She knocks on the door, and this white woman comes to the door, and my mother says, does she have an apartment? She says, yes, let me get the keys. My mother says, gracias a Dios, un apartamento. thanks be to God, an apartment. The woman turns to my mother and says, are you Puerto Rican? My mother says, yes. The woman slams the door in her face. We don't rent to Puerto Ricans. My mother's walking down the street, and she is crying like you have no idea. I turned to her and I say, mommy, what's a Puerto Rican? She says, you are, and don't you ever forget it.
Nobody wanted to look at the fact that we were a people of color. In this country, that meant black. And in the United States, that was a great obstacle because this is a racist society.
I remember junior high school and West Side Story coming out.
The shots are clear, cause every Puerto Rican's a lousy chick.
I think I was in the fourth grade, and a group of Italian American children came out, and they asked me, are you Puerto Rican? And I said, yes. And they started to beat me. I got kicked, and they would chant, hit the Puerto Rican. And other people just stayed and watched. And I think my mother remembered that. So she would allow us to play in the roof. She would go, ¿están okay allá? Mira, esto no lo oigo. Sometimes we jump from roof to roof, but that was our playground. And it's amazing now that none of us got hurt.
In El Barrio, as a young person, even 13, 14, and 15 years old, if I had to cross Second Avenue, I would put a pebble in my foot, in my shoe, so that I would go limping, so que me cogieron pena que no me dieran. It's simple, that's what we did. You had to find ways or schemes of how you're gonna get across the street. If I was going to 110 in Manhattan Avenue, then it was wiser for me to put a cigarette in my mouth and look tough. There's a certain walk. You had to walk like you owned the neighborhood. And those are the things that your mother didn't teach you, neither did your father. You learned it in the street and you pick it up.
I was ready to become a fully political person. I was ready to understand why people were poor. And I was ready to understand that there were preferred people and there were unpreferred people.
She began to really take in a political way. I'm a New Yorker. I'm here. I deserve to be here. I'm gonna get what other New Yorkers get. I think that was probably a transformation, a kind of a political switch.
We started to talk about that, and I said, well, why don't we meet in my house? Or maybe, do you have other people you could invite? And soon we had a group of people, of young people who were in college, interested in doing something about what was being said about Puerto Ricans and the situation of Puerto Ricans. We used to raise hell and, you know, and have a party and dance and go to bed late, but also we used to evaluate our work and talk about the philosophy of the group. We got to the point of saying we ought to select a section of the population and work with.
And I was in the room and she says, I have an idea. I want you all to become leaders. I want us all to start thinking about leadership roles that we can have. It's going to be through education. It's going to be to getting us to look at what the issues are and the concerns that we have.
So for a woman to come in and start making a considerable wave within the community was not only an act of courage, but a matter of real a stamina and perseverance to get her points across.
We're beginning to now say Puerto Rican New Yorkers. And that's what we are. We're not Puerto Ricans from Puerto Rico. We're not New Yorkers, period. We're Puerto Rican New Yorkers.
Thank you.
I had envisioned that you would organize groups of young people in which it would be like a gang. The club would be like a gang, kind of family. And I thought it has to be a movement. And you had to give them the things that the gang will bring. Identification with a jacket, with symbols, with ceremony.
Aspira is probably the first Puerto Rican owned and controlled organization in the United States. They created Aspira clubs in high schools, and they had a centralized staff that developed a curriculum for working with the youth in the high schools, but also they would have workshops at the Aspira offices.
Everything we were doing was new. We decided we would not have counselors, we'll have organizer counselors, because that was a new concept. They had to have the personality of an organizer, and at the same time train themselves in being counselors, educational counselors, like the counselors in the high schools. The name Aspira, a one word upbeat that incorporates in it the whole sense of what we're talking about, a command. Aspirar, aspira. A command to the kids. That age is the one point where you can interfere and come in and break the cycle of poverty and break in and bring in knowledge where the young can change the world.
My parents were very proud of the fact that I was like an honor student. When my father read the article in El Diario La Prensa, and he spoke to my mother, and then he called me over. He says, mira, nena, esto es para ti, you know? It's an organization that helps high school students who want to go to college. Y esa, esto es para ti. Así que vamos a ir allá and see if, you know, they can help us. At that time, the executive director of Aspira was Dr. Antonia Pantoja. And so she was the person who met with us. She turned to me and she said, we're organizing Aspira clubs. And would you organize a club in your school? We organized it. We called it the Juan Morel Campos Aspira Club.
When you grow up in a neighborhood which you venture very little out of, that's your whole world. I came from what you might call the wrong side of the track. This organization named Aspira, it brought me out of that other world.
My world was the Lower East Side. And all of a sudden, New York City came into focus for me. So Aspira really opened up new horizons for all of us.
I remember my father asking me about the cost of college, and I would tell him, que papi, it would probably cost $18,000. And I say, mijo, you know how much that is? You know how much I make? It was through Aspira that I began to realize that I would likely to attend college. With their help, and I learned about financial aid and scholarships and applying to different schools.
Another thing that I noticed was a lot of girls were in the club. We did have like the talks, presentation about the history of Puerto Rico, about the culture, but we also learned social skills too, this whole process of interacting. We used to have lots of parties, and we learned how to do the boogaloo. The boogaloo.
But I do recall when I was a student in Aspira, some of the controversy that surrounded Aspira for, you know, for many years.
The Board of Education was number one obstacle. They said, we don't accept those counselors you have because they don't have a license. And we said, tough. We don't counsel in your facilities, we counsel here. Second objection. So you want to segregate Puerto Ricans from the rest of it. I said, oh my God. When you segregate them, it's okay. When we do it, and this is not segregating, this is organizing for our own strength. And to have them finish school and not drop out. I used to get letters, abusive, and you know, with all kinds of horrible language, and calling me all kinds of names, and calling us all kinds of things. Taking our money here in New York, go back to where you belong.
those members of our community, including for a period of time in the 60s, the more radical elements in our community who said Aspira was, you know, just creaming. And it was just focused on the cream of the crop of the Puerto Rican community. And I was not the cream of the crop in terms, I lived in the projects and my parents were working class. So I always used to say, what is this, you know, what are they knocking here? If it's bringing people who are developing a consciousness into truly understanding the needs of our community, what's wrong about that?
We go into our culture and we say, okay, the areto. The Taino Indians used to celebrate an areto, where you drank something and you danced and you became imbued with a sense of an important moment. And the areto is held in a dark room, you turn off the lights, and everybody has a little candle, and you get light from the center candle.
We all be sworn in as an aspirante, all walking in with our candles, all nicely dressed, and it made me proud of being a Puerto Rican. It was...
In 63, we would discuss in our club meetings, you know, what was happening with the civil rights movement and how the situation of Puerto Ricans was so similar to what was happening to African Americans at that time. So it was like a way of seeing, my God, you know, we're not stupid like they say we are. You know, we could really do this. It empowered us to feel that we had the capacity to gain these skills and the capacity to transform society.
They bloomed and they flowered and they became these fighters. Some of them became young lords. Some of them became the student revolution of the 60s. Some of those people got their heads, you know, badged by the police in closing City College.
Because we came from Aspira, we were already planners, we were already organizing. We had organized in all our high schools already. Those that were graduating from high schools weren't getting into the city colleges, so we called for a boycott. At 7 a.m., I was in my Volkswagen Beetle Bug, came right on the campus, cops said you can't stay. I said, brother, it's time to get out. We're closing down the school. This is now Harlem University.
We have sealed the campus after a series of assaults and fights as college opened this morning.
And they got a hold of Buell Gallagher and got him by the neck and closed his office and stood on his desk and told him, you're not going to get out of here until you listen to these demands.
One of the things that we wanted to see was City College reflect the diversity of the graduating classes of the city's high schools.
Number two, a separate Black and Puerto Rican School of Studies.
It wasn't a building they took over. They took over the campus. This was a major event. My phone starts ringing off the hook because my friend's telling me it's aspirantes inside.
Today, you look at the City College of New York and it's like 70% minority, which is a major accomplishment. All came from what it used to be 3%.
We started to learn from the youth what was happening to them in the schools.
When I first went to kindergarten, I was slapped by the teacher for speaking in Spanish. And I went home and told my mother what had happened. And my mother did not know how to speak English, but she went over there and she gave them a piece of her mind.
There's a law that says that they will take you to jail if you don't take your children to school. Let's turn it around. Okay, If there's a law that says that I have to take my children to school, then I can accuse you as an institution where I have brought my children and you don't teach them.
Now, in those days, we didn't talk a lot about special education. And you heard about open air classes, you heard about special health classes and so on. But Puerto Rican youngsters often were put into those classes, even though they had no problems with their health or anything like that, but the school system didn't know what to do with them.
Why we had an 85% dropout rate? Well, if the kid doesn't want to be seen by the teacher, and they don't understand what's going on, they don't speak English, and the classes are in English, you know what you're doing? You're dropping them out.
There are no funds in this budget for a number of programs, such as producing and purchasing special instructional materials to help the teachers in the disadvantaged areas of the city. There are no funds to help increase the number of Negro and Puerto Rican teachers in our system, nor any incentive fund to encourage new ideas to be tried out in the districts.
I became like a lion.
The discussion was beginning within Aspira and other community groups that it might require litigation to obtain some of the goals that we were striving for.
This was a lawsuit of major importance to the Puerto Rican community. And this was in the time of civil rights and people bringing all kinds of actions on the basis of the fact that they were being denied due process, they were being denied an equal opportunity.
And we won. The ruling was called a consent decree that said that the Board of Education in New York City had to teach the children in the language of their culture.
Dile la palabra.
Mantequilla.
A todo el mundo.
Mantequilla.
And teach English in an effective way.
Pamela, what number comes after the two?
Three.
There's no question in my mind that had it not been for the consent decree, we would not have gotten Latino teachers into the school system at that point.
The War of Education is a big monster to fight. And I fought the monster. I knew that, okay, now Aspira is there and you have to move on. You have to open up space for others to come in. And one day I had to leave and I packed up a whole household and went to San Diego to become a professor. Life has these forks in the road where you might have in front of you three possibilities, two possibilities, four possibilities. It's a very important moment in which your life is going to change drastically. I had taught in Columbia University, and my students, you know, I had to really prepare. Because if you didn't watch out, you know, they might have read three other books that you didn't read. California is a strange place, you know. And I find out that they haven't even read one article or the assigned chapter. I felt a little lost out there. But they will sit across the table from you and tell you, oh, I see an aura. Oh, I see your asthma, you know. And you know, I could take you to a place where they can take your asthma out of your chest. I see it. So I would say, well, look, let's let the doctor do that.
It was a community that was a Navy town, very, very conservative. Now it's changed a lot, but it was very, very conservative, very racist in its policies and its practices. I met Antonia Pantoja. She had come to San Diego State University for an interview. We shared teaching courses, teaching syllabi. And I felt myself being more and more drawn to her. She was like a magnet. You couldn't possibly, you know, not be engulfed with this personality. You knew that this was a personality. And I remember one day saying to myself, you're in love with her. That was it. It was my first experience having anything to do with a woman. She was so forward in things that she thought about. I mean, she thought about things before other people thought about them. Somehow she had this gift of timing, and she wasn't afraid to move on what she thought.
A number of students were meeting with us to try to invent different type of university. What would it be like? Every Sunday and every Saturday, we take a car and go up and down the streets in different neighborhoods. You see, the city of San Diego had a whole area where they had the porno shops. And it was the sailors who came there. And there's this building in the corner of Fifth and Market. And we see it as a sign for sale. So we thought, oh my God, maybe we could buy that building. Mina said, yeah, with all the bombs around and all the prostitutes.
I remember going to the Zebra Club, and they used to, the bouncer was a one-armed lesbian. This woman had one arm, one little arm. She had scars. And I watched her beat up a Marine who tried to pick up her girlfriend. Beat him up with this little stuff. Scared me to death. I was like, okay, well, we won't be hanging out here.
People said, you crazy, gonna be in the middle of all that crud? So we said, well, don't worry about it. You know, that's gonna be fixed. You have to have a imagination and see things, have vision. We bought the building.
We organized the graduate school for community development. We had art programs, we had research programs, we had youth programs, particularly youth entrepreneurship programs, leadership development, galleries, theater.
It was a whole multicultural third world, which is what attracted me to it, which is like cross-pollinization. It was just so exciting because at that period in time, you never heard of anything like that.
I was a budding feminist, and it was hard to find places that would let you be both artistic and political. That was the time that I heard about Rainbow Rep. It was just this flurry of cultural excitement.
She provided amazing experience and resources. I mean, we were just young artists, insane young artists, having a good time. I mean, you're 20, 22 years old going, cool, let's do it, whatever.
The strongest part of the school was the artists, because we used to teach art for community development. The idea was the concept of community. You cannot build community without art. You cannot build community without values and philosophy. And then you cannot build community unless the individual, the single one person is fully developed, and then you build community.
We operated the graduate school for, I would say, approximately 14 years together.
Her talks would just really speak to the core of me. And I will never forget, and this was a billion years ago, she sat us down and she said, you do not wait for someone to give you permission to do your art. And I am telling you, if you look at my body of work, you know, after that I did the Kathy and Mo show.
Yeah, Philip has the AIDS. I mean, AIDS! Well, our group counselor encourages us to say it as often as possible and as loud as we can. Yes, he says, you whisper it, you give it shame. You yell it, you conquer it. That's right. Come on, Carol, say it with me. Come on. AIDS! That's right. Don't you feel empowered? Make you feel better? Come on, doesn't that feel good? One more time. AIDS! That's right. Good for you, honey, say.
You do your art no matter what. You know, don't take no for an answer by any means necessary.
So I'm the president of a graduate school, 3 or 4 years, and I retired. One day I get a letter, and it's a letter inviting me to go to this conference to Nicaragua.
sat in that room, and you're discussing a theme, and all of a sudden, the whole room starts saying, Sandino, vive, 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 vive. La lucha sigue, 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 sigue. You got your hair stands up.
The national security of all the Americas is at stake in Central America. If we cannot defend ourselves there, we cannot expect to prevail elsewhere.
How could our country support the Contras? We went to a village right next to the frontier with Honduras. One day they came in and said, get in the bus, we're gonna meet Borges. Borges was the commander of the Revolutionary Army, and he was supposed to be a very solid man of integrity and a man everybody liked. And he says, where's the Puerto Rican? So I said, oh my God. So I got up and he says, come here. So I go over to him and he embraces me and kisses me on both cheeks and tells me, I wanted to meet you because I wanted to let you know that the situation of Puerto Rico in the Americas is unique. And you were the one child that remained in the jaws of the lion. I called Mina from there and I said, I think I'm gonna stay in Nicaragua. And she told me, you have an unfinished business. And I said to myself, yes, I have an unfinished business in Puerto Rico. I have done all these institutions in New York and I've done all these things all over the United States. And I never went to Puerto Rico and did this. I have to go back. The tropics have a smell of its own. The tropics are enchanting and the tropics get all your romance of yourself, the mystery of the self. I always believe in the mystery of life. And when I arrive here, I get immediately in connection with that, with the mystery of life and the fact that one should be able to enjoy that mystery and connect to it. And then there's this other thing, this ambivalence. At the same time, you come into and see all the beauty of the road and the new development, and you feel like, look, it's beautiful. It's a complete different place than the place you left. When I left, it was very poor. Not only the physical poverty, but the poverty of the people, the lack of resources. Finally, you come to the understanding that, yes, something has happened that is good for the island, for the people who live in it, but still, we who live in the United States understand the price of those advancements and that beauty and that false economic development.
We went to Puerto Rico to retire, and that was the first, probably, misconception of who Tony was, because it was impossible for her to stop working.
Mira, esto es un guineo más papo.
Ah, sí.
Para pasteles.
Pero como ella empezó a hablar de la doctora Perry, la doctora Pantoja, especialmente Pantoja, hacía falta muchos servicios como correo, servicio de salud, que era fuerte y sigue siendo fuerte porque nosotros vivimos muy lejos del pueblo, son alrededor de 16 kilómetros. Y aquí, si a ti te da algo, en lo que llega a Canóvana, es prácticamente hombre muerto.
Well, how could we say no? There was a village of 10,000 people waiting to learn community economic development.
For 2 years, we met every Thursday with this committee. And by the end of 1 year, we had incorporated, and they had selected from a saying that they knew from Ramón Emeterio Betances that said that trabajar es producir y producir es liberar la comunidad.
Created Producir, which is a magnificent community development project, which I think could be a model to developing nations. And I've seen it and I've been involved in watching it grow.
We're trying to go for what are the new techniques of doing things in the country. You know, instead of having oxen come over and plow, you know, in the old way, let's do hydroponics.
Ella preguntaba a la gente y dialogaba con todo el mundo. Ella era una persona que no era ese tipo de persona orgulloso ni nada de eso. Ella compartía con todo el mundo.
People themselves were very open to the idea. We didn't get a lot of difficulty. We got difficulty from churches who did not want to upset traditional roles, female and male roles. And we were working with women. This proved to be a problem for both the churches and also for some of the husbands who didn't want to see their wives develop in this way.
There was a woman who did embroidery for us, and she was going to teach embroidery. And then one day she came over and told me, "Doctora, no puedo venir más. I cannot come anymore to the project." And I said, "Why?" She said, "Because every time I come here, I have to put money in the box for the minister. And he says that these things are the devil. That what you're doing is the devil." So we had a competition with the devil. I changed a lot by living in the United States. I became somebody else. The difference in the culture is too big. I'm 79 years old and I am not sitting down, you know, counting the beads of the rosary. I don't have my long hair tied up in a knot with pins, and I don't have a shawl around myself. I'm still functioning. I'm a vibrant person, 79 years old. That's not the way the 79-year-old woman is in Puerto Rico. So where am I gonna fit? I fit in New York. I am a New Yorker. So that the book had to be everything that I am. I am producir, and I am aspira, and I am the Puerto Rican Forum, and I am all the people we've met with, and I am my community. I am me and my community. And you see that I spent my whole life teaching about community and teaching about who you are and what you can do in this world.
She wrote memoirs of a visionary. She always felt that people had this sense of placing her on a pedestal and sort of adoring her as this public person. But she knew that they didn't know anything about her.
People who are on a pedestal, they can fall. And I know that leaders can have clay feet. And I've told some of the, especially some of the youth that had been around me in this kind of adoration, I said, "No, don't do that. Don't do that because I am a real human being, and then one day you'll find my clay feet and you will be disappointed and you'll be angry at me."
And she was a very personal, private person, very private. She wouldn't tell you anything about her. She wouldn't ask you anything about yourself. But all of a sudden, bam, in your face was a book that told all. Interestingly enough, it didn't tell the thing about our life and the fact that she was a lesbian, which is the one thing she kept private.
I mean, looking back, a lot of the professionals that created Branca and created HIRE and created ESPID and the Puerto Rican Forum. A lot of the leaders in education were people who contributed incredible amount to the Puerto Rican community, themselves were lesbian or gay, but chose to keep that part of their life silent, not discuss it. And Tony was one of many people who did that.
Society has made such progress on gay and lesbian rights, but that is relatively recent. And the idea that you would have a gay and lesbian educator working with young people would have raised eyebrows as short ago as in the late 80s, early 90s.
Si tú tienes un hijo o una hija o un nene o un matrimonio, lo que sea, eso se habla en familia. We were, as Puerto Rican, I think the culture, I mean, the culture is changing. It's changing because it's Americanizing. That's very important, by the way. Because when I read your statement, what do you mean about coming out? She didn't have to come out. She was always there. She wasn't hiding. You understand what I mean? But it wasn't part of the social fabric of the discussion that took place.
We're here to award the highest honor our nation can bestow on a citizen, the Presidential Medal of Freedom. Paz e respeto, peace and respect. These are the values that define the life and work of Antonia Pantoja. Her efforts to create educational and economic opportunity for all Puerto Ricans have made her the most respected and beloved figure in the Puerto Rican community. Through Aspira, the educational program she helped to found 35 years ago, she still dares young Puerto Ricans to dream and to work to achieve their dreams.
No matter how many resources she got, in her heart, she was a poor person. She had an identification with the poor, and she had an identification with the kids.
How many people here plan to attend college?
My goal for this conference is to start encouraging people that are younger than me to start getting involved in the community, start doing community service projects, do walks, contribute.
If you're going to tell a lady you're very pretty, you're beautiful, you don't holler her, psst, because we're not dogs, we're not objects. That was in the old days, we're in 2005, new millennium, new things.
Ahora mismo hay muchas personas que dicen que la juventud de ahora no sirve, pero eso no es verdad, porque yo sirvo, yo lo sé. Me lo dicen mis padres, me lo dice Aspira.
Through the process of that first interview with Dr. Pantoja, my father says to her, he says, bueno, doctora, ¿y cuánto va a costar esto? And she said to him something which I never understood at the time, but really has gained much meaning over the years for me. She said, no, 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 esto no cuesta nada. Si cuesta algo, la que va a pagar es ella. And she points to me.
Today is a very special day.
In 1963, barely 2 years after starting Aspira, Tony Pantoja already had the vision of all those thousands of young people who would go through Aspira, who would, upon reaching adulthood, have the consciousness of saying, you know, it's time for us to do something for our kids today, and giving that.
I had a lot of inspiration from women in my life, my grandmother, my mother, and I mentioned Tony always in that context. She was one of those who had enormous impact on my life. I met her in Aspira when I was 14 or 15, a long time ago.
I am me and my circumstances. I am that person that is here now in front of you, and I am everything that is behind me, everything that has made me, and everything that will be after me. So I'm very full of myself. And because I'm very full of myself, well, I'm in possession of the moment and in possession of... this is why I'm not afraid.
The birthday girl. How
are you? 80. 80 cuentas. 1955, and this woman says someday in the city of New York, you're going to see the signs put up in Spanish, and this city is going to become a Spanish-speaking town, and there'll be signs all over the streets written in Spanish. I laughed my head off. I thought she was crazy. That'll never happen, okay? Of course, I was wrong.
She saw herself as an institution builder. She saw herself as a community builder.
She created important institutions. And for that, she will always be remembered. But out of those institutions came a whole lot of people who bought into the vision of Aspire and Attain and Give Back. And I think hundreds, if not thousands and thousands of people have Tony to thank for that.
People were asking about the future. And what do you do about the future? You make the future. You make the future. I make the future. We make the future together.
Major funding for VOSIS was provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. Additional funding was provided by the Ford Foundation. Additional funding was provided by the MacArthur Foundation. Promotional support for VOSIS is provided by Hispanic Communications Network, a leading educational media company for U.S. Hispanics. To learn more about this episode of VOSIS, please visit www.vosis.tv.
Continuamos este programa didáctico cultural. Ahora disfrutarán del concierto musical del taller Tacuafán titulado Caribe Jazz. Tacuafán, en sus 37 años de trabajo cultural, ha desarrollado una serie de actividades didácticas culturales para toda la comunidad y los estudiantes en Puerto Rico, en los que se encuentran simposios, talleres musicales, foros educativos, grabaciones musicales y hasta películas documentales. Actualmente, por la consistencia en el trabajo cultural, Tacuafán ha sido incorporado en el programa Música como Recurso Global, una iniciativa de la Organización de las Naciones Unidas con la Universidad de Nueva York. Este taller Tacuafán, titulado Caribe Jazz, fue grabado en el 2006 en el Teatro Francisco Arribí de Santurce, y en el cual se experimentó con el género del jazz, pero con los ritmos autóctonos de la música jíbara, la plena, la bomba, la danza, y participaron en el mismo grandes artistas y músicos puertorriqueños: Eric Figueroa en el piano, Tony Batista en el bajo, Pedrito Guzmán en el cuatro, Richie Flores en la percusión, Endel Dueño en el timbal, Jimmy Rivera en la batería, Furito Ríos en el saxofón y Piro Rodríguez en la trompeta. Continúen disfrutando de este programa cultural y espero que lo disfruten. Recuerden apoyar y contribuir al programa de Educando con Cultura Tacuafán, donde al final del concierto verán información relacionada. Muchas gracias.
Bye.